Welcome to today's Council on Foreign Relations Symposium on the Future of Democracy. This session is entitled, Can Democracy Be Saved? So we will be responsible for whether you leave here depressed or optimistic. I'm Carol Giacomo, a member of the New York Times editorial board, and I'll be presiding over today's session. My panelists are Adrienne LeBas, Tom Carothers, and Josh Kurlantzick. So I'm going to ask the three panelists to first start out very shortly, very quickly and succinctly, making their main points on this subject, and then we'll engage in discussion. So, Josh.
Okay. Well, thanks everyone for joining and for sticking around for the last session. I hope we can offer you some suggestions. I'm going to say two things, one of which is probably actually not that optimistic, and then I'm going to talk about one success story last year. And I also want to say that I think there were been a lot of questions about China, so I'm happy to get into China in the question period, but I feel like it's too much to get into all of these things right now. First of all, I want to say one thing about which is the current democratic regression is that I think it's important to understand that there's been a fair amount of research about this, that there is actually a point where in a number of countries where if you reach a sort of stage of democratic regression that it's very hard to get back from. And we're seeing this in a number of states. And I want to go through just a couple points of why that is, why it's hard to, once you've sort of crossed that Rubicon, to come back. And then I'm going to talk just very briefly about Malaysia. And one of the reasons why, once you've sort of crossed that Rubicon, it's hard to get back is, A, we've seen in a number of places where populist or sort of populist elected autocrats have taken control or have won elections and taken control that they have undermined trust in institutions and in the media in a way that even if there is, if they exit the scene in the future, that it's very hard to sort of rebuild trust in those institutions, that media, and you can actually have further populists or further people who muddy the waters in the future. So in Italy, you had Silvio Berlusconi. Although he finally did leave the scene, or he sort of left the scene, you now have sort of a legacy of chaos and non-fact-based discourse in many ways, and a new generation of populists coming to the who have come to the fore and are running the country. In other places, for example, like in Thailand, which is the place that I know best, you had populists come to the fore. Undermine the rule of law and constitutional institutions while also being elected over and over and over and over in the 2000s and even into the 2011s. And you now are at a situation where it's very hard to retrench and get back the things that existed before then. Trust in the media has been destroyed. Institutions have been completely subverted. The whole idea of fact-based discourse or even discourse between actors in society has essentially collapsed. And actors who want to even push the country forward, they don't really have any ground to stand on. Also, in a place like Thailand and other places where we've seen already democratic regression happen to a point that, to me, almost it's hard to get back, the institutions that would have existed to sort of bring democracy back from the ashes, or at least have some degree of basis to stand from. The judiciary has been so politicized that absent, you know, a complete leveling and restarting, it would be hard to build again. The election process, unlike, say, in a place like Malaysia, which I'm going to talk about now, has been so corrupted that you've gone from having sort of like elections and that, while not completely free or fair, are utterly shambolic. And one of the things that happened in Malaysia, which I'm going to get to, is although the system had existed as kind of a hybrid democracy or a hybrid authoritarian system, it had not gotten so far that elections had gone beyond the pale and they were able to hold a free enough election to oust the autocratic government. So sorry for that downer. I know this hasn't always been a upbeat day. I do want to say 2 minutes about Malaysia. So in a year or last year that I think Freedom House called one of the worst years for democracy in the last 15 years, and amidst a fair amount of research suggesting that actually the global democratic regression actually has gone back almost 20 decades, not the mid-2000s, as many people have thought. One interesting example last year was Malaysia. So Malaysia had been run by essentially the same coalition since it gained independence from Britain. It didn't seem to have that much chance of moving forward, of shedding an autocratic and increasingly corrupt regime that existed for the last few years. And yet, in May of 2018, Malaysia held elections in which that government was defeated. And after a very, very brief sort of interregnum where it seemed like maybe there might be some funny business, the prime minister, the former prime minister, stepped down. The institution and a new government was formed. And there has been quite, I mean, we can talk if people want to talk, but there's been, it's not 100% better, but there has been a real resuscitation of many institutions. There's been a thorough, real rebuilding of the judiciary. There has been accountability for people who are in the previous government. Civil society, which was already strong enough that it hadn't been destroyed, has bloomed again. The media has gone from being really, you know, it wasn't a North Korean media, but from a state-like media to being really a fount of real discourse. And so I think one of the things that would be interesting to look at Malaysia, or there are a few other examples that I'd be interested to get into, is what happened there that has been so contrary to the trend of not just last year, but really the last 15 years, or some would say going back to even the early 90s. I think I'll leave it there, and then we can come back.
All right, so we have in Malaysia somewhat of a positive example. Tom, can you talk about, what conditions are necessary to try to rebuild a country like Malaysia or Turkey or whatever, and does the United States still have a role?
Yeah, I want to get to the U.S. role, but let me start by highlighting something that's come up in some of the panels but hasn't really been fully fleshed out, which is we're living in an age, it's not just democratic recession, and in fact, I think that's not a good frame for what's happening in global politics. We're living in an age of a massive increase in large-scale citizen protests against their governments. Over the last 5 to 7 years, if you just do a simple chart of large-scale citizen mobilizations that basically are anti-governmental, there's just a tremendous surge going on in the world. These are occurring in democracies, sometimes against a specific party or ruler, like in South Korea. Sometimes they're occurring in democracies against the whole system, like in Romania, where anti-corruption protests are just a pox on all your houses. They're happening in what Dan Slater called earlier electoral authoritarian regimes, like Ethiopia or Armenia, where we saw a big burst of protests in the last couple of years. And they're happening in autocracies. We've been reading about Algeria the last few days, Sudan. So all around the world, in all different kinds of regimes, we're seeing these very large-scale citizen mobilizations against power holders. When you look at the motivations of these protesters, you see a couple of things. One is that one of the primary drivers is public anger about corruption. My son, Christopher Carothers, and I published an article last year where we brought to attention a simple but startling fact. 10% of governments in the world in the last 5 years have had their terms cut short because of public anger over corruption that erupted into the street and drove the rulers out of power. That's a high mortality rate. So it's corruption has become a primary driver of political change, but you also have economic injustice, indignity, and sometimes just pure repression. So we're living in an age of activated citizens that are angry against a whole series of types of regimes. And you know, it could well be that in some alternative planet, there's a conference going on called Will Autocracy Survive? And they're sitting around, they're saying, God, look what's happening in Malaysia. This is terrible. Oh my gosh, Armenia, we thought it was one of ours. Ethiopia, it was our best developmental state in Africa. Algeria, who would have thought it? This is terrible, we gotta have more conferences. And there's a doppelganger of Rita Hauser who sponsors these, who, you know, and they're sitting, you know, scratching their heads saying, what's going on? So we need to get some perspective. All power holders are struggling to make empowered, educated, angry citizens happy. And so we have to be careful in thinking that this is a problem of democracy. It's a problem of politics in an age of empowered, networked citizens. So I want to start with that. Let me just get to the U.S. role, then we'll reflect on this. Now, the U.S. role, when I was reflecting on the topic of, you know, what to do about democracy, I thought somebody ought to at least pose the question and say, can the United States still be part of a solution of repairing democracy in the world? The fact that we have to pose that question is in some ways a sad testament to where we've come to, but it's a reality. Because if I talk about the US role in promoting democracy in the world, any of you with at least just a small measure of skepticism, which you should have, would ask three questions. How in the world can we be out supporting democracy when look at the track record? Look what happened in Afghanistan and Iraq when we tried to do this. What a mess. Please, I don't want to do that anymore. Secondly, who are we to tell the world, look at our own system. Oh my gosh, we have no credibility going out there. And third, look at the president we have. He's busy cozying up to this dictator or that dictator. So we got to just check out of this business. That's wrong. Okay, now, it's not an ideal starting point, I'll acknowledge that. If you were choosing where to start from, I wouldn't take those three conditions. But let's look at each of them just very briefly. First, Iraq and Afghanistan are not typical examples of U.S. democracy support. The U.S. has been engaged in over 100 countries around the world, whether it's helping Slovak civic activists or people in Bolivia and the indigenous movement in different ways, in Mongolia and so forth, and focusing in on the two most exceptional cases and treating them as the pattern is a serious analytic mistake. Secondly, the US democracy is a mess, so we can't have anything to contribute abroad. That's the wrong way of thinking about democracy support. Democracy support is not about exporting your system. It's about helping other countries empower themselves, learn lessons from others, figure out their own answers to the problem. So if you come to them and say, you know, getting a parliament or a Congress to work well is hard, we're struggling. Let's work together on this. Let's have a comparative conference and talk about what have we learned about this and what have other countries, where are some positive examples? You're still perfectly credible, as long as you're willing to admit your shortcomings, focus on comparative knowledge, and use your weaknesses as strengths in that regard and say, this is tough. We know it's hard for these reasons too. So there's no reason you can't do it if you're troubled. And third, yes, the president is not democracy promoter in chief, but he's not the only part of the US government. He is the only significant person in the US government whom I know of who doesn't believe in this, basically, that the United States should in some way embody and try to advance democracy. Today, the US government is spending as much on democracy assistance programming as it was in 2015 and 16 under Obama. There has been no decrease in US democracy assistance around the world. Why? Because Congress is fully behind this. Congress is turning back a budget that the administration presents them and says, no, we're going to keep doing this. Today, hundreds and thousands of Americans are going out and trying to work on a cooperative basis with people in other countries. So we're still doing it, despite the diplomatic efforts of the president in certain ways. But those aren't all of the United States, US government, and US society. So the United States still does have a role to play. It needs to up its game and, getting back to the civic activism, take that seriously. Work more on issues like state capture, crony capitalism, corruption, which are really motivating people. Focus on those kinds of issues. Focus on the more comparative angle on this work. Dan Slater again mentioned that Indonesia, Japan, South Korea, these are not, quote, Asian democracies. These are very well-functioning democracies in some ways. Partnering more with other democracies to show that we can work together with non-Western partners on this issue. And working with civic activists in new ways, getting out of our old NGO models and focusing on the new kind of leaderless movements and doing more there. So there's lots to do, a lot of potential, but the world is a much more dynamic and complex place than the simple framing of it's a democratic recession and we've got to get out of this business because we're no longer qualified.
I just want to push back on you a little bit there. I totally agree with you that there are other, you know, Congress has been funding these programs and often speaking out, perhaps not enough. But when the president has the bully pulpit and he is the, you know, the leader of the country, the extent to which he embraces authoritarians and doesn't speak out on behalf of these issues, values that this country has long espoused, isn't it hard for the others to really have, they don't have the same clout?
Yeah, look, it's devastating. He shouldn't be doing that. It's a disgrace, and it's terrible. Okay. But, you know, a Brazilian friend of mine in November last year, right when it was, you know, Bolsonaro was gaining steam and it was clear that he was going to be elected, said, actually, we want to come learn from the United States because we've been impressed in the last 2 years how institutions like the New York Times or the courts, other civic groups and others have been able to, so we see a lot of positive lessons in the United States. We actually want to come now and learn from the United States because we feel we may be entering a similar period. And so, yes, the president is doing all the wrong things on this issue, but he's not the whole country. And others around the world are seeing that institutions can stand up to a leader like that, that they're, you know, democracy is a business about institutions and norms and checks and balances and so forth. So I'm not saying it's a pretty story, but I'm saying it's not just a one-sided story.
Okay, Adrienne.
Yeah, so I first want to sort of, I guess, dispute the title of the panel. So, you know, I think from my standpoint, I'm an Africanist, and there's tremendous variation across the continent, over 50 countries. But for me, I think that the question that we should be posing is, first of all, can the democracy that exists be saved? But also, can we assist in any way in the deepening of democracy? Because certainly in Africa, we're not talking about well-functioning democracies that are sort of rolling back. There has been some erosion in the standards of democracy that exist. But we also have a large number of low-intensity or liberal democracies. And then we have a number of also what could be termed electoral authoritarian regimes. And I think when we're talking about foreign policy levers, we have to talk about both democratic deepening as well as protecting what's already there. So I certainly think that both of those tasks are things that we can do. And I think I'm glad that Tom made the case for continual US relevance, because I also believe in that. I do think that we need to be creative about three different issues, though. And you know, I think that our current foreign policy, not just in the United States, but also our European allies, has maybe not either addressed these or has taken the wrong tack on them. So first of all, elections. How can we improve election quality, and especially citizen belief in their elections to actually deliver outcomes that are consistent with their preferences? And I think that for a few years now, there's very much been a focus on electoral integrity, and a large amount of money is going towards tech solutions, incorporating biometrics, these kinds of very sophisticated way of improving the technical quality of elections. But I will say, as someone who's spent some time in Nigeria during election periods, these kinds of tech solutions are very easily on the ground sort of circumvented. And so, you know, there is this question of whether it actually improves the quality of the count, the quality of voting. And I think the recent results out of the Democratic Republic of Congo, where there was, again, a large investment in these technical platforms, and yet we saw a result that was rigged. An opposition candidate did win, but it wasn't the one that actually won. So, you know, I think that there's that. But then there's also the question of citizen trust in elections. And once again, Kenya, 2017, one of the most expensive elections on the African continent, worked out to, I've seen figures of around $25 per capita. And yet, Kenyans do not trust their elections or their electoral commission any more than they did before the 2017 elections. So that's sort of first issue. Second issue, the quality of intermediary institutions, the quality of political parties and other pressure groups. You know, I think that we can talk about some creative ways of building those up, but certainly we have a crisis of representation in sub-Saharan Africa that is really about the ability of citizens to aggregate their interests together and to sort of hold their governments accountable. And, you know, I think the same kinds of crises that we see in the industrial economies in terms of the decline of trade unions, we can also talk about the decline of particular vehicles of representation that existed in sub-Saharan Africa. And then third, this, I think, is the most important elephant in the room that we're not talking about enough, which is the rule of law. And we certainly are talking about the crisis posed by transnational criminal organizations, transnational terrorist organizations. We've seen the collapse of the rule of law across the Sahel, for instance, and in the Horn of Africa. These things can directly damage democracies. The fall of democracy in Mali was a lot about the rise of these kinds of actors. But we're not talking about the more generic, sort of less dramatic erosion of the rule of law within countries, and just basic security for citizens, and basic policing and all of the rest. And my concern about this is not just because it goes to the issue of institutional effectiveness within these low-quality democracies, but it also creates space for the rise of non-state actors who could be providing citizens with security, but could also turn predatory and may not have democratic tendencies, or may have an interest in keeping democracy and government weak. So I think we need to be very creative in thinking about how to build up African states and states in other parts of the developing world in order to allow them to deliver services and to function well enough to make democracy work for citizens.
All right, so let's talk about specifics. How do we do it better? What's most urgent? How do you prevent rule of law from eroding? How do you, I mean, trust is a very ineffable thing. And so how do you build trust in a government or in a system? Josh, you want to start with that?
Well, I have a couple things. I mean, a few things that one would be to encourage countries to adopt media regulations that are fair. We actually used to have that in the United States 32 years ago, but we've abolished it. And I think that it's been problematic for some of our media discourse. Britain has it. Some other countries have it. Some Southeast Asian countries have it.
What do you mean by media regulations?
A fairness doctrine would be an already equivalent of that, something that allows for when broadcasters are on the air, they have to present, especially during election time, they have to present multiple sides of multiple political parties. In Southeast Asia, anti-corruption commissions, and especially empowered ones, have played an important role. In Indonesia, the president, who is up for a second term in a few days, he hasn't done a great job of empowering the anti-corruption commission, but he's done a pretty good job. And in a country like Indonesia, that's a really important actor for pursuing graft and also for sending the message that against impunity. I think not only in the US, but other countries where gerrymandering is a problem, we have to address that. That was a problem in Malaysia. They managed to actually overcome the gerrymandering in that election, but for decades it distorted Malaysian elections. I want to mention one other thing which is relevant that we haven't brought up. I think that it's important in situations in which someone is elected, genuinely elected, but doesn't necessarily conform to upholding the rule of law or protecting democratic institutions and norms, that those who are opposed to his or her election don't then default to sort of anti-democratic or undemocratic means of hoping to oust them. That has happened actually fairly significantly in Southeast Asia. You saw it in Venezuela in the earlier days of Chavez's rule, and still there was some sympathy for that. I mean, I don't want to draw this too far, but I think the idea that a sole figure, a former FBI director, is going to solve all the problems that have been created by sort of an elected politician in the United States who some might think is undermining norms and institutions is sort of an extension of that idea that your problems could be solved by sort of an immediate intervention. And I think that, certainly in Thailand, for example, that was a huge problem. People who were opposed to figures who were undermining the rule of law but were genuinely elected, they defaulted to an undemocratic means of removing that elected leader, which has now plunged the country into a further cycle of deteriorating democracy. So I wanted to make that point too.
Well, look, citizens are going to trust their government if it's relatively representative of their interests. It's at least somewhat honest and at least somewhat competent. Now, representativity has been hard for the democracy community because there was a big focus in the 80s and 90s on political pluralism, elections, party development, and so forth. That was good. That was important. But many governments that are quite pluralistic are not very representative. A good case in point is the South African government. South Africa is a democracy. It has quite a bit of freedom. It has genuine elections. Yet, because of state capture, and a group of people who've sort of occupied the system and made corrupt dealings with important business people and built into the parts of the ANC corrupted patterns of behavior, it's become an unrepresentative elected political party. And so we got so focused and we had so much in our mind, a spectrum of from an unfree country to a free country, that was the direct line we wanted to move along. You could have a country that was very free but very unrepresentative because political elites had captured the system and working in crony capitalistic or other corrupt ways with that, with the business sector and other interests. And so we've got to really focus more on broadening our thoughts about representativity and helping other governments and our own do better on that front. So that's one of the key concepts where I think looking back on it, we overestimated the fact of pluralism and thought that would cure. You'd just kick out the scoundrels if they behaved in bad ways, but they dug themselves in, developed opaque patterns, traded power back and forth, and we ended up with elected but not very representative governments.
Adrienne.
So I think there is good news from the standpoint of sub-Saharan Africa. You know, the support for democracy remains really robust. So over 80% of Africans still believe that democracy is the best system. But this crisis of trust in institutions goes pretty deep. And I think that one of the reasons for that is just the enormous gap between the ordinary citizens and the political class. And historically, the way that you bridge that gap is you build rooted parties that go all the way down to the grassroots. And so citizens feel like they have these vehicles or these channels through which they can communicate with the political class. And I think that one of the crises of democracy right now is the role of money in elections, not just here in the United States, but also in Africa. African politicians are now hiring US public relations firms and electoral advisors. And there is also an increased role of sort of vote buying in a whole bunch of these elections. And I think the real challenges that we see to democratic trust come from vote buying and the use of violence during elections. And both of those I see as substitutes for rooted parties. So if you don't have strong rooted party organizations, then you can get by with buying elections and sort of sending your thugs to capture ballot boxes and all of the rest. So I think that we need to sort of figure out a way of building stronger parties. And I think that maybe sounds very early 20th century, but I do think that that's the kind of channel that we'll see. And I think the place where we're most likely to see those emerge is in cities. And we see this incredible expansion of urbanization all over the developing world. And I think the other reason that I'm hopeful about cities is these have generally served as sort of laboratories for democratic governance in Africa and other parts of the developing world. So these are governments that tend to be captured by opposition parties in sort of party-dominant states. And that might be one way of sort of beginning to build these kinds of parties, build them at the local level within individual cities, and then maybe try to nationalize them from there.
All right, I'm gonna ask two more questions and then go to the members. Nobody's mentioned Turkey, Hungary, Poland. Members of NATO, either members of the EU or in Turkey's case, an aspirant to the EU, those bodies, part of the raison d'etre was we'll bring all these countries in and it will help them, it will help them strengthen democracy and we'll all go forward into a happier future. Clearly that hasn't happened in those three cases. Turkey in particular is just going off the rails. What happened, and does that suggest that those mechanisms are not really useful for encouraging democracy? Tom, why don't you start with that?
Well, different things happened in each of those three countries, and it's important to see that. So in Turkey, first of all, it was not economic decline that triggered an angry public response and embrace of an illiberal leader. Turkey was doing fantastically well economically, precisely during the years of the AKP's rise and Erdogan's consolidation of power. So there you have a fundamentally divided society between two conceptions of what a modern Turkey should be, a secular, somewhat more pluralist one and a more Islamist-oriented one. And those two visions have been confronting each other, and one of them's been winning and winning in a way that crowds out the other and doesn't want to tolerate it, and has a skilled leader who's a remarkable political entrepreneur who's been able to mobilize a base and use it and so forth. Hungary is very different. Hungary's democratic decline was triggered by economic crisis. 2008-09 financial crisis hit Hungary very hard. A lot of Hungarians had loans in Swiss francs and other foreign currencies. They became devalued, the loans 30%. Payments skyrocketed. The Socialist Party that was running the country acknowledged they'd been not doing a very good job of it. And Orban came into power on a wave of the country's falling apart. I'm going to save it. We need a second revolution to push these old leftists off the stage. And because of the way the unusual Hungarian electoral law was, he got 50 to 51% of the vote back in the late 2000s, but got 67% of the parliament. It's the only European country in modern history that's had one party with more than 66% of the parliament. Just do a little thought experiment. Imagine one of the two US parties had a 67% majority in both the House and the Senate. Wonder what would happen politically in this country. I don't think it would be very pretty. If they could do whatever, they could modify the Constitution, add some interesting provisions to the Constitution. They could do all kinds of things. Well, he did. So he came on the back of economic crisis, had an unusual electoral situation that vaulted him to the ability to fiddle with the fundamental rules, took full advantage of that, and moved the country in a different direction. Very different case than Turkey. And then Poland, again, remarkable economic success. Poland was the one country in Europe that wasn't really hit by the 2008-09 financial crisis. Banking sector wasn't very exposed to it. Yet, they've slipped into this illiberal, conservative, populist rule. So there's the puzzle there of how it happened that the right in Poland, the center right, split into a hard right and a more moderate right. It's a kind of a long story, but a different story there, having more to do with cultural change, sociocultural change, Poland's feeling of being out of sorts with itself, and kind of deep cultural divisions within the society between a sociocultural conservative sort of faction and one that's more liberal and cosmopolitan. Different story than the other two. So each of them is a different story. We have to be careful not just to say, oh my gosh, the liberals are on the rise here, here, and here. Each one has a different trajectory and different reasons.
Right, but I'm trying to get at solutions. I mean, does bringing people, bringing countries into NATO, bringing them into the EU have a positive effect when it comes to democracy?
Look, if Orban weren't in the European Union, then it would probably look more like Azerbaijan. So, you know, it's good that Hungary is in the EU because at least he knows he's going to get some pushback, as he had, not as much as the EU could or should have done, or from the European party formations. So it's good that he's in the EU. It wasn't a vaccination that prevented it, but it has helped constrain it.
Adrienne. So, one of the narratives presented earlier today for the rise of sort of populism in Europe is this kind of chafing against membership in the EU. And I think that when we look at Africa, the effect of regional organizations has actually been the opposite. It's sort of advanced democracy, or at least policed certain red lines. So, you know, if we look at the people's led movement in Burkina Faso in 2014, the regional organization in West Africa basically pushed back against attempts by the incumbent to hold on to power. We saw a similar defense by regional organizations around the Gambian elections recently. Going back earlier, you know, Zimbabwe hasn't turned out well, but there were at several points in time the regional organization in Southern Africa, again, pushing that government towards a more acceptable stance on the treatment of opposition. So, I mean, I think that these regional organizations can be sort of bulwarks if they have enough members who really believe in democratic norms.
Josh, do you want to say something
just
quickly?
Just briefly, I mean, I think in a region like Southeast Asia, where essentially the regional organization is quite weak, ASEAN is quite weak and has little to no interest in human rights and democracy, you can see sort of something with the value of the EU, in which essentially the ASEAN pays no attention to human rights and democracy. But I did want to also add to that one thing Tom said about sort of the difference between the president and sort of people working democracy policy from the on the ground, who's, you know, have the same commitments in the past. There are places like in Southeast Asia where that sort of high level rhetoric by the president, particularly in a region where China is probably more assertive than anywhere else in the world, I think does matter. That doesn't mean that the people on the ground aren't doing the same good work, you know, actually NDI was thrown out of Cambodia, but in Cambodia or other places, but that the president's rhetoric has a significant weight in places like Cambodia, Thailand, Malaysia, et cetera, where at the same time there's a real counterforce that doesn't exist in a lot of other parts of the world.
Okay, members, I'm going to err on the side of picking women as long as you raise your hands right here in the second row.
Hi, Wendy Lewis from the Foundation for Civil Society. Tom, this is for you. Democracy funding, as we know over these years, have been used by different administrations in different ways. The most egregious recently was the use of the funding of some Cayman Island thing in Cuba, where we were using sort of a false Twitter and a false other. You know very well about these. And you, as having taught at CEU, which is now in Vienna, tell us more about why Orban has been reelected and what is the view of the citizenry in Hungary or in Poland, in any of these places, in reverting back to something more representational. Thank you.
Yeah, Orban has had a good 10-year ride for three big reasons. First, because of his parliamentary supermajority, he's been able to manipulate the system, especially media ownership and media control, that he's created an information environment that's very favorable to him. Second, he's been the beneficiary of having taken the reins of the country right at the moment of financial crisis and enjoyed the 10-year recovery, which is not his own doing. All of Europe has been recovering slowly. In fact, Hungary has been recovering a little more slowly than Slovakia and some of the other countries. But he gets the credit from the population of, gee, that's been a pretty good 10 years compared to what came beforehand. And third, he did catch a cultural moment in Hungary with a sense of sociocultural change that was especially triggered by the wave of migrants who arrived in Hungary several years ago. He was able to seize on that, just as the president of this country has made a lot of the immigration issue, but he made even more of it there, and the country was startled by the arrival of a lot of people from Syria and other parts to the south, and he grabbed that and made it a big issue. So the information environment, the economic situation, and the sociocultural moment, particularly because of migrants.
And democracy funding?
Well, that's a big question, Wendy. but I would focus in, you're right, the Cuba case was an example of a small amount of funding that was being used in a way that was very pointed politically. And when democracy funding is used covertly for what really looks like, in a sense, quote, regime change, where you're really targeting a specific person or group of people in power and saying, we want you out, that doesn't build a consensus for such funding. But US funding, just like Swedish funding and Japanese funding in this area and Canadian and Australian and others, there is a lot of such funding that gains legitimacy by being open. It's supportive of actors. It works cooperatively with governments when possible, and when not, it works openly with civic actors who have real legitimacy in the countries and so forth. So we see some exceptions on democracy funding that's done badly, but the world, you know, there's a great deal of democracy funding by lots of actors that's appreciated and quite effective in many parts of the world.
Other questions? In the back, please.
Miriam Safi, CFR International Affairs Fellow. So in Foreign Affairs, Stacey Abrams made the case on how identity politics can actually strengthen democracy. And she talked about the increasing diversity within our electorate here in the United States, but also issues around voter suppression. So my question is sort of your thoughts on her argument and ways and the mechanics and the machinery, gerrymandering, suppression and in this country, some solutions.
I'll let you. That's a good question.
Yeah. So I'm glad someone brought up identity politics. You know, I think that when we talk about the developing world, often there's this fear of sort of identity politics or communal differences in plural societies creating a very inhospitable landscape for democracy. And I think that there are a couple of reasons that we should be optimistic. Reason number one is that kind of diversity is actually becoming more diverse. So people are moving into cities, and we're seeing marriages across ethnic lines now, and we're seeing the rise of new kinds of identity in urban spaces. And so I think, you know, that is reason to be very optimistic about our future. I think that it's an increasingly urban future, and for that reason, it's an increasingly less divided future on some sort of cleavage lines. The second reason that I think that identity politics is not as scary in the developing world as we think is that I sort of am one of these believers in the idea that conflict is actually the sort of crucible for democracy, and that we're more likely to get sort of democratic societies that share sort of agreement on norms, on institutions, and have trust if they've gone through the process of sort of fighting over those institutions and those norms and those identities. And so, you know, I think that polarization can be scary in the moment, but it can also forge these kinds of compromises that are central to what democracy is. And so we can all point to democracies that seem very ethnically divided, very ethnicized, very dangerous right now. But if we take a longer term perspective, you know, maybe that's just what the birth pangs of democracy actually look like. On the gerrymandering and all of the rest, I don't have solutions in the American setting, and I don't have solutions in the developing world setting either. Enormous kinds of problems of differential representation, certain constituencies being more represented than others, and the power of redistricting I think we're only beginning to understand this now outside the American context. As Americans, we've known this for a long time. But I think that authoritarians across the developing world have learned that lesson and been using it without a lot of pushback from US government actors. The other sort of technical barrier, I think, to the deepening of democracy that I would flag that concerns me a great deal is the rise of sort of candidate nomination fees and the role of money now inside internal African party primaries. And this, I think, is the major threat to democracy, for instance, in Nigeria right now.
Josh, did you have something?
Yeah, I was just going to add one minor point, which is that actually, I mean, the scale of gerrymandering redistricting obviously has become much worse in the U.S., at least dating to 2010, because of the use of more sophisticated computer modeling, and that's obviously one of the issues that's before the Supreme Court now is how to judge the standard. I was just going to mention that we're now only catching up to that, and a lot of developing countries are now have the accessibility that, for example, the North Carolina in the case and Maryland that's being challenged at the court now. Now that leaders in developing countries have, in some countries that choose to use it, have that level of technology, you're going to see all sorts of things similar to like the maps that are in North Carolina, Maryland, et cetera, and that's going to be very problematic.
Can I say a word about voter suppression? It's an interesting thing. As far as I know, I've looked around a little bit, comparative work. The United States is the only established democracy that has a major party that, to some extent, is dedicated to voter suppression. So that raises an interesting comparative question. Why is that? Why are we the only ones that are fighting, you know, 200 plus years after establishing a democratic republic, we're fighting over basic electoral rules? It's kind of an interesting puzzle. I think there are three reasons. First, we're the only major democracy that has a fundamental debate about the role of the state. You know, we have people in the Congress who don't really think there ought to be taxes. We really shouldn't have a modern state. You know, we have a fundamental debate in the United States about the role of the state. That, you know, the German center-right is to the left of the Democratic Party in terms of its role of the state in society. So the United States is still having a fundamental role of the state, and that filters down to election administration and a skepticism about how much central control to have over election administration process, how secure is it, and sort of queasiness about that. But the two more important reasons are we're the only established democracy that is approaching a sociocultural tipping point of the established racial majority becoming a minority. So, you know, Canada and Australia are going to get there if they keep up the immigration that they're doing. But the United States is further along that than any other OECD democracy. And so you're reaching, you know, an uncertain racial majority becoming minority, and voter suppression is a, you know, a kind of a tactic to deal with that. Third, we're locked into a two-party system because of the first-past-the-post voting system we have. There are not many fixed two-party systems in established democracies. Most are parliamentary democracies. The UK is an exception, a couple of others. When you have that, you can't have another party spring up and offer an alternative. If we had a multi-party system, the Republican Party would probably split, as would the Democratic Party, into two. And so what happens is one of our major parties is sort of locked in. It can't really become... It sort of moved to the right in these ways. It sort of stuck there, leaving this center there, which we can't fill. And so you have a complex set of factors that have led to this puzzle of why a mature democracy like the United States would experience a major party whose goal is anti-democratic in this way, in terms of suppressing votes.
Well, that's encouraging. There's a woman in this row, third, fourth row.
Hi, I'm Sarah Rapucci. I'm with Freedom House. I'm going to throw you guys a question that I get all the time, which is when we think about democracy being saved, we think about the success stories that have happened recently, Malaysia, Armenia, Ecuador, Angola. I'm wondering if there is, if you see a trend there at all, if you see anything that links those, or if they, I mean, of course, they are very different cases, but is there something that is binding them together at all that might be tipping us in the direction of a change in the trajectory globally?
Who wants to start?
Common thread. I mean, I think some of the things you can draw from Malaysia are, like I said, the election process had not proceeded to be a completely shambolic. Gerrymandering had not gotten so bad that it was unable to be overcome, given that the the combination of the already existing opposition party made an alliance with a previous prime minister who was able to bring in some, Mahathir Mohamad, who's now the prime minister, was able to bring in some more voters and sort of overcome the seawalls of the gerrymandering. And that there, the Malaysian opposition demonstrated a pretty significant willingness to compromise, which I think is actually pretty unusual in a lot of states, given that their party was the largest. Their leader had been put in jail. Actually, he had been put in jail before by the guy, Mahathir Mohamad, and they were willing to make an alliance with him in order to oust the government. So they were pretty pragmatic, which you don't see in a lot of elections. And a third thing in Malaysia is that although Malaysia had been a hybrid state or veering closer to outright authoritarianism under Najib, civil society had been constrained, but it was still quite vibrant. And there were several rounds of large public, as you know, anti-corruption protests and a continual hammering on this theme in the public that catalyzed the election. And then there was a sort of catalytic event before the election, which you can't get everywhere, but it came out that the prime minister probably, the former prime minister, allegedly, you know, stole like $700 million or more. And so those combinations of things offered the chance that you don't have always a sort of one-time opportunity of all these things coalesced. Pragmatism, a character who could unite both the key opposition actors and people who were probably skeptical of the government but weren't ready to defect before. Civil society that hadn't been completely eradicated and then sort of thrown into their laps, a perfect opportunity to exploit the rising fueling anger over corruption at exactly the right time. So I don't know enough about Ecuador to say whether that can be replicated. It was similar, but I think
anybody,
Malaysia enjoyed a like perfect storm.
No. Yeah, actually, that's a good basis, I think, for the comparative look, because there are, you don't want to push it too much, but there are some common characteristics. One is they've all been in countries that maintain at least a certain amount of electoral seriousness, even if they're electoral authoritarians, but elections are real. In Armenia, it was a semi-authoritarian state, but elections still had some meaning. Same with Ecuador, even at its worst moments under the leftist center or leftist populace of recent years, and true in the other cases. So first, elections that are still genuine despite the restrictions on the elections. Second, just the fatigue factor of people overstaying their welcome and not realizing the accumulating anger of the public about corruption, the arrogance of power, and so forth. All of these cases, Armenia, Malaysia, Ecuador, Ethiopia, and elsewhere, the Gambia, were cases where people had really didn't realize how far down the road they had gotten in terms of the public accumulating fatigue. And then third, fairly talented leadership that emerged kind of surprisingly in Moreno and Ecuador, you know, a leader from the very party of Correa, but who came in and said, you know, we could do better. And a talented leader who had some convictions. In Armenia, a talented leader who rose up with the street protests and so forth. And you look and you see in each of these cases, usually one or two leader figures who captured this moment of fatigue and electoral openness to create a process of change.
Adrienne, do you want to add to that?
Yeah, I generally agree with what Tom has just said. I mean, it's the combination of sort of fatigue. It's just really hard to hold a sort of party-based authoritarian regime together in the long haul, right? And so it's going to be harder and harder to keep that level of elite cohesion, particularly when we're seeing this mobilization from below, which is something Tom mentioned earlier. I mean, I think we are seeing a sort of explosion of citizen politics. You know, when I look at sort of good news stories from Africa, you know, I think that the protests that have emerged around term limits and other kinds of constitutional provisions, this is really what gives me some hope. We still have citizens who live in some places in straight up authoritarian regimes, right? DRC, straight up authoritarian regime. It's not that the citizens think the term limit is going to give them democracy, but they know that it's a first sort of step and they have to claw back each inch of institutional space. And I think that that is what sort of keeps me in the game. You know, I think there's an incredible vibrancy at the grassroots, and the trouble is how to aggregate that up and connect it to sort of political elites and connect it to electoral politics. Because certainly protest culture is vibrant. It's just how do you institutionalize protest culture?
Didn't you write a book called From Protest to Parties? You were just waiting to mention that.
Okay.
A little plug here. Okay, more questions? Over here, gentlemen, and on the end.
Thank you, Mark, Hannah, Eurasia Group Foundation. Pew Global Attitudes Project put out a poll. One of their survey questions was asking about American ideas about democracy, and they found that largely in South American countries and African countries, there's a lot more support for these ideas than in European countries. And what Bruce Stokes, of the project, sort of generalized was that countries that have more experience with Western-style democracy have a lower opinion of it than countries that have a less experience. Can you make sense of that for us?
Who wants to take a crack?
So I'll start just because I think that this issue of sort of youth politics, this is my attempt to put sort of youth onto the table. I mean, I'm sort of there with you that certainly your sort of experience of democracy is going to shape what you expect. But I think in a lot of these countries, what we see is abstract support for democracy, but very low evaluation of the democracy they actually have, right? So people are able to differentiate. And I think just your democratic experience, I mean, 70% of the African population is below the age of 30. And so, you know, what kind of experience do people actually have of anything? So, you know, one of the arguments out there is, well, if you remember authoritarian rule, then, you know, you're going to remember why democracy is so important. Or there's the contrary argument. If you remember authoritarian rule, you might be sort of nostalgic for it. But I think that we're now moving in the developing world towards a sort of entire generation of people who have lived in these illiberal democracies and only have an experience of flawed democracy. Or flawed competition. And I think that, you know, the big puzzle is how long can that gap between your actual evaluation of your own democracy and your abstract support for democracy, is that sustainable over time? And I don't know.
I mean, a different way of putting it, that's the same idea, but it's just that I think in countries that have had less experience with democracy, people still feel more democracy would be the solution to the corruption, the incompetence, and so forth, more representative, more responsive, et cetera. So they say, if we just had more democracy, we could get there. Those countries that have experienced relatively full democracy for several generations feel like they've already tried that, and they're frustrated. So they don't think, so their estimation of the value of democracy is lower in that sense. So it's potential versus reality a bit.
More questions? Sir.
I'm Massimo Tommasoli from International Idea. I wanted to get back to one of the elephants in the room that Adrienne and Tom mentioned, which is the quality of intermediary institutions. Clearly, political parties are crucial for democracy, but they are the weakest link, to quote Tom's book. So what are the concrete recommendations that you may provide on building stronger parties and what you just said about Africa and what applies also to Europe and the other countries?
Who wants to start?
I mean, I'll take a stab. I did write a book about it. So I think, you know, that as I suggested, there's a lot of vibrancy at the grassroots. There's also a lot of money that goes to civil society assistance from the United States and other donors. I don't see those two as connected right now. So I think that a lot of the civil society assistance that is there goes to a set of actors who I think are doing very valuable work, a lot of human rights documentation, a lot of the sort of monitoring of corruption and all of the rest is done by these kinds of civil society organizations that we're supporting. But I don't think that we're thinking about associations as building blocks of parties. And we're also not thinking of grassroots associationalism as, to use Tocqueville's term, the great schools of democracy. And so, you know, I think that maybe rethinking the kinds of organizations that we target or pay attention to and sort of looking at little block-level associations. I work in Lagos a huge amount now, and we've been working in partnership with these marketplace associations, which are sort of these, in the absence of the state, they govern the marketplaces and enforce corruption and arrange services and all of the rest. I would think if I were a party builder, that would be a really powerful source of organizational capital. And I think making sure that those networks are sort of maybe the basis of a rooted, accountable, internally democratic party, that's something that we don't really think about at all. And yet the politicians on the ground know that these are fantastic vehicles for organizing votes, and they generally tend to buy them. So, you know, how can we sort of make sure that that organizational capital is something that is supported and, you know, supported for democracy?
Tom?
Yeah, I think that's a great answer. You also have to keep a system. It's party systems that manage to renovate tend to be party systems that the barriers to entry aren't too bad. So, you know, we saw the example earlier that was mentioned of Germany, where the Social Democratic Party has been in a kind of secular decline for a while. But the Green Party, a sort of a rebel party, which was able to enter the system because the parliamentary threshold is too high in Germany and the financing system is very coherent and you're not shut out of financing even if you're a new party. Green Party has come along and is rebuilding the center-left in Germany. So that's good. Slovakia, we see the recent electoral results there, which are very positive in liberal democratic terms. It's a system where it's fairly easy for parties to get started and get into the system. Party systems that have collapsed are those where the barriers to entry are high, like Italy in the 1990s when the Christian Democratic Party and the Communist Party collapsed in a wave of scandal because the two parties had a lock on the system, didn't allow any other parties to enter, sort of had the rules set up in a way that was very hard to exit or enter the party scene, then you get party collapse over time. So just like any sort of organic system, there has to be, the barriers to entry have to be kept in a reasonable, you know, at a reasonable level so that there can be entry of new actors that challenge the old ones. And when you look at US parties, because we're locked into the two-party system because of our rules, it's only through reform of the parties that we can get any party reform, and we know how difficult that is.
No. So I think we've come to the end of our time. Thank you all for being here. Please help me in thanking the panelists.